Hello, I'm Michelle Young with USF Health, and I'm here with Dr. Christian Bréchot. He is a professor at USF, as well as the Senior Associate Dean for Research of Global Affairs, and he is also the president of the Global Virus Network. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
We appreciate your time. This is a really important time for someone like you that's such an expert on viruses and more to be able to talk to us about COVID-19.
Sure.
So thank you. There's been a lot of conversation in the media and on social media about flattening the curve. Can you explain in simple terms what it means and how do you do that? How do you flatten the curve?
Yeah, this is the major question, I would say, presently in the US and worldwide. Schematically, when you have an epidemic, you have a first phase, which is really a slight slope with a steady increase in the number of cases. And then, and this can be very sudden, we reach a threshold where you have an exponential curve. You have really a kind of a burst of the number of new cases. This is what happened in Wuhan, in South Korea, in Italy, and now in France, and this is what we want to avoid in the US. And so flatten the curve, it just means that to prohibit, to prevent this exponential increase, you see. And once, unfortunately, you have reached the exponential increase, you can try to get a plateau, which then will precede the decrease. This is what we have been seeing in China, because now they have reported that they have no more new cases, which is a great news. And also actually in some cities of northern Italy. So how do you really flatten this curve? How do you prohibit, do you prevent having the exponential curve? And once again, you have the exponential curve, you really succeed to have a plateau. How do you do that? Well, actually, strange enough, it's both simple and complicated. There is only one way to readily act, and this is social isolation and containment. And the only reason why China, and maybe to some extent Italy, and I really South Korea, and I really hope also for France in the next weeks, have succeeded or will succeed, is because you need to be strict on social isolation. So it seems, you see, in these modern times, with so many technologies, so many scientific progress, well, we come back to a very simple principle in infectious disease. Now, obviously, and this is something we can discuss further later on, you have therapeutics, you have vaccines, you have other means. But basically, this is a way you can really reduce the number of cases.
You've talked a little bit about it already, but what are other countries, what measures are they taking to flatten the curve? What has been successful for them?
Yeah, they have been very strict, and this is very unfortunate because it directly hits the economy and also the social networks in these countries. But it's really about asking people to stay at home. Very simple, but hard to convince many people not to go to close restaurants, cafes, to cancel all the events. The point that they have done is that they have been very strict on this. In China, they even in Hubei, in Wuhan, where the epidemics came from, they had drones to survey, to monitor the population. In Italy, they have been very strict in northern Italy, in South Korea also. So what we can learn from these countries is that if you cannot avoid having people who do not obey to the rules, you have to enforce these rules. This is very unfortunate, but when you keep seeing some people who keep living a normal life, that's not possible.
Great answer, and that really makes a lot of sense for us here in the US and also worldwide as well.
Yeah.
Do you think the world's reaction to COVID-19 is a representation of how we would react to a much worse virus?
Well, that's a very important question. First, I really want to start from just a step back. The SARS, the first SARS epidemics in 2003, as well as the HIV epidemics, have been kind of a warning call, you see, a morning call in a way to wake up, you see. And it has led to a lot of progress in global health worldwide. We have, this is on the political agenda, I don't want to go into detail, you have the WHO, you have many progress. Yet we have been caught by surprise again. We knew that virus would come and that respiratory viruses are a threat. So the answer to your question is, yes, we can expect other ones. It's not if, it is when. So how can we prepare better? I mean, we must build on the success. This is why I started with the success. But really what we see is that we have improved our capacity on vaccines. For example, following up on the Ebola crisis, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovation, so-called CEPI, has been shaped between academics, industry, government, to really prepare in advance stockpiles of vaccines. And this is excellent. And they are working on vaccines against SARS-CoV-2. But what we have been left apart is really of activities on diagnostics. It is incredible to see that we are lacking diagnostic tests. And also, what is going on presently is really about drug discovery, repurposing drugs which have been used for other diseases and which can prove useful for the treatment of this SARS-CoV-2 infection. So I would say that we have to prepare better for the next ones by coordinating our strategies. Quarantine, how do we run a quarantine? Can we agree between the different countries? And then a better preparedness for diagnostic tests and a very large effort on drug discovery and repurposing.
Makes a lot of sense. So with our global economy and frequent international travel, will pandemics become more frequent? Do you think that we have some lessons learned yet that will help us with future pandemics?
Yes, I'm sure. We will have, again, we had SARS-CoV-1 in 2003, HIV, we learned a lot of things. Ebola crisis, we learned. We are going to learn and we will need to learn from what's going on. The humans are completely changing their ecosystem. It's about urbanization, deforestation, human migrations, climate change. So yes, we have completely overhauled the connection between the animals, and this is why these viruses come from animals, and their environment, and the human environment. So yes, we will have others. Respiratory viruses will always be the most contagious, you see? And so they are a severe threat. So we have modified again our ecosystem in a way which will favor, unfortunately. But we can learn and we can adjust and we must adjust.
Change is inevitable, isn't it? For sure.
Yeah.
From a global perspective, what are some of the more promising COVID-19 treatments that researchers are working on, especially those that could be available sooner?
Absolutely. Before speaking of treatments, vaccines, we will have vaccines, that's for sure. But even though the first are being tested now, it will take 1 year, 1 year and a half before they really get to be available for the population. So, as you said, we have to rely on therapeutics. Strange enough, we do not have specific treatment for coronavirus. What we are doing is to use drugs which have been used for other diseases, and this is what I call repurposing, and we do have several possibilities. We have molecules which are really antiviral, some remdesivir, for example, or other anti-HIV, which seem we have to be very careful. We have a lack of information, we have to be very careful. But remdesivir seems to be useful. So that's one way. So an antiviral, which has been used for another virus, but which might work on coronavirus. Second, you have drugs which act both on the virus and on the cell to protect the cell, such as chloroquine, such as nitazoxanide, and there are many trials which are now being used on this. Then you can go for reducing the inflammation. What is very striking is that when, unfortunately, you have 15 to 20% of the infected patients who develop a severe form with respiratory distress, 5% of them really being in a very bad shape when they are young, much more, unfortunately, when they are older. So what really triggers this respiratory distress is the inflammation. A bulk of cytokines, inflammation, immune response. So now, several trials are aiming to reduce this inflammation. And so this is maybe a combination of all of this that we will have to use. So there is a huge effort on the therapeutics. I really believe that we will see a lot of progress rapidly. It will not completely solve the point. But I really hope that this, and again coming back to quarantine, social isolation, which is really the basis, then we can really control this pandemic. Now it's more than an epidemic, and really save lives, because it is so sad to see the increasing number of patients who die just now.
So the final question would be, what's your message for people that say, I got things I got to do. I got places I got to go. I want to go on this trip to wherever, even domestically. What's your message to them right now?
We are all together. We have to be together. When you are young, you can get the virus. Do not show any symptom, but you will contaminate other people. Your family, old persons, fragile persons. This is a shame. We need to be all together, and that's the only way you curb an epidemic.